we here? Well, we're here. We're going to talk about another one of our movies for the channel.
Yeah, that's we're going to be talking about In the Mouth of Madness. Yeah. In the Mouth of Madness by what's that guy? John Carpenter.
Well, it wasn't by John Carpenter.
Well, he was director.
Yeah, I was a director and the composer as well for the soundtrack. You have very little experience with this movie.
Yeah, yeah. You actually recommended this film, and I really wanted to do it justice by immersing myself. So I watched the whole thing and alone in the dark.
Yeah.
And I was expecting a really, really scary time, you know, because, you know, it's kind of Lovecraftian.
That's his big selling point.
Yeah, it's Lovecraftian, and I went in with some pretty high hopes. And yeah, I know Lovecraft isn't for everybody. It's for me. I enjoy it. But this movie is actually more of a good time than scary. I wasn't really scared by it.
Well, yeah. I mean, that's also the kind of conclusion I came to when I first saw it. But how I came to this movie was a little bit different than most people. But I saw it maybe 14 years ago with a friend. And it was Halloween, and we'd went to Blockbuster Video to pick up whatever they had left on Halloween night. And what we found was In the Mouth of Madness and The Wicker Man with Nicolas Cage. We're not going to talk about that other movie. not today anyways, or ever maybe. But we found this one. It wasn't scary. It had some good scenes in it and some really interesting visuals, but it was just a good movie. And I've watched it, you know, at least once a year since then, maybe not always on Halloween, but it's one of my favorites. And, you know, just thinking about movies that deal with Lovecraftian topics, this is like the only one I can stand. I don't like the genre as a whole. I think it's pretty preachy. I think it can get caught up in itself. It can make itself seem too psychological. And not enough monsters.
Well, you know, that's the real problem is, you know, Lovecraft deals with these things that, you know, even in the writings, there's not a whole lot of description. You know, it's like people saw it and they just went insane.
Yeah, or they say it was an indescribable horror. And sure, that works good for telling your story to a guy right beside you. But in a book, you got to describe things. And in a movie, they rely on that to create these monsters to put on screen. So
I think they did a fair job, though.
I mean, they did good.
When you consider what you have to work with, that all you really know about these Lovecraftian horrors is they're fleshy and they're not quite right, you know.
They're fleshy and they're extremely fleshy. They're almost, like, John Carpenter had a lot to do with it, but all the monsters kind of look like they're fused together.
Yeah.
And I like that look.
Well, he was kind of made for it, you know, like in The Thing.
Yeah, this was The Thing by about 10 years.
Really?
This was filmed in 93, and it was just after Jurassic Park hit, and Sam Neill, the star of In the Mouth of Madness, really started to demand bigger roles, and this was a movie that he took kind of as a risk, and it was a strange movie for him to take at the time. You're coming off one of the biggest movies of all time, and then you go to this. A little movie shot in, actually now, I'm seeing it's in Southern Ontario.
Really?
Yeah, it's shot around Toronto and Markham.
Oh, nice.
So it passes for a sleepy upstate New York town pretty closely. It's a beautiful movie. I liked a lot of the scenery. The sets are great. I'm surprised they found so many weird set pieces and architecture. I liked it.
Mm-hmm.
Visually, I have no problems with the movie. I could watch it a bunch of times and still find interesting stuff to stare at and look at.
Yeah, like, it's not a bad movie. We might come across as we're, you know, ragging on it or something like that, but it's enjoyable. It's not scary, but, you know, John Carpenter movies, I don't think are scary.
Well, he's like Sam Raimi. He deals with what could be terrifying topics, but he deals with them in a way that's lighthearted almost. He's enjoying his time directing and creating these things. And it shows. Like, he obviously loved making this movie, as well as the actors had fun working inside of this world that was crafted for them. I have nothing but good things to say about this. And, you know, I'm reading a lot of people, it's a love or hate thing completely. And I understand that. I understand. I can see where this is a pretty bland movie. I mean, if it's billed itself to be Lovecraftian supernatural horror on the highest psychological mind-breaking degree.
Well, you know, maybe Lovecraft is just bland. I like it, you know, but I can see too. It's not for everybody.
But I could see it going south very quickly with a couple bad choices, and they really get close to a couple of those choices.
Like what?
The very cheap camera tricks that they use to, well, not cheap, I don't want to say that, but a lot of their ways of telling the audience that there's a weird situation. It's camera tricks, camera filters, and it's so obvious and so blatant.
That's where you're wrong. It's all real.
It's all real. It's real. It's a good movie. I would recommend it to anyone that doesn't... Their idea of horror isn't jump scares. If they like horror stories, this is a horror story. Plain and simple. It's just a very good one. I come away with this. It's one of my favorites. It's going to stay on my shelf for a long time. Plain and simple.
Mm-hmm. Recommended.
Recommended. All right. So, after this is now the second review in the bag.
Right, right.
So, we're going to move on to number 3, and this is his choice this time. So, stay tuned and keep watching our channel.
Good night.
Thanks for tuning in.
Good night and good luck.
Stay safe.